You see this yet? You know, all of your shit comes down on my head.
Oh, Frank, look.
Let me talk. It's like you're a big bird with radar, and I'm tired of getting hit.
Is this my fault?
This is nothing. I've got union lawyers threatening me, and it's talk of a walkout.
Well, let them. They're not teaching anything down there anyway.
Then it's your job to
not
do something about it.
Not one of them has a personal stake in that school, Frank. Not one.
The fire chief was just here. He says it's illegal to bar those doors. Mrs. Barrett is organizing a parents group to try to get you removed. Since you insulted them at that meeting the other night when you just suggested that they get off welfare.
Oh, I didn't mean
that. Because the fact is, quite a few of them need it.
Look, I wasn't talking to all of them, Frank. Now, look, you came and recruited me, man. You disappoint me, brother. You disappoint me.
The disappointment here is you.
Me?
Yes.
Look, you know who I am. You know me 30 years. You knew what I would do. You know
how
I operate.
Nigga, can you keep quiet? The fact is, you're screwing up. You're alienating everybody. Look at you, you have no life. Your wife left you. I ought to walk out on you myself.
Well, go ahead, bail hell on out.
But I said I would back you up.
That's what you said, Frank. That's what you said.
Brother, I will go through the fire with you. But you are not taking care of business. This shit you're pulling now, you're just gone plain loco. Now, you suspend Darnell. What the hell was that?
Darnell is symptomatic of the disciplinary problem
that
we're having in this entire system.
Young black teacher. So he dumped that desk right on top of your head. Well, right on. Good for him. You will reinstate that man, you hear? And then you fire Mrs. Elliott. Why? Because she didn't want to kiss your ass. Well, I wouldn't either. How about that?
Mrs. Elliott has an ego.
Yeah, well, you lost the best teacher we had. We couldn't get her back now if we wanted to.
I don't have time for Mrs. Elliott's problem.
Well, you better make time.
We are being crucified by a process that is turning blacks into a permanent underclass here, Frank. A permanent underclass. No, see, nobody wants to talk about that. Nobody. Mrs. Elliott's missionary zeal about Mozart has nothing to do with our problem. Nothing. What good is Mozart going to do a bunch of children who can't go out and get a job?
Joe, your personal battles are going to cost us the war. Worry about the test scores.
What the hell you think I'm worried about, Frank?
End of discussion. Debate is over. You will write a formal apology.
I will what?
A formal apology for your treatment of Mrs. Elliott and Darnell and for your vicious and thoughtless insult to the women of this community. You will kowtow, you will step and fetch.
Frank, if you think you can
get used to it, it's the way of the world. If you're so hot on discipline, then goddammit, start by accepting mine. Because contrary to popular opinion, I'm the head nigger in charge.
Attack skills and vocabulary too. Coming hits in the disc edition, it's all brand new. You're through. I'm interplanetary like Doctor Who. So who?
Fuck your beef, no relief. I step on stage, girls scream like I'm Keith.
What's going on, everybody? Ring Time Pro Wrestling is in the building. We almost did not have a show, but somebody said, hey man, Keith, if you want to run this operation, you got to get your ass up. Or you're going to get fired. And I said that to me. I almost fired myself. I was like, look, I don't pay you to lay on your ass. I understand you got another job, but this is important. Look, man, it was a rough mirror conversation. But it had to be had. I had to tell Keith that I was tired of his insubordination. I was tired of his slacking off and all out laziness. And this won't be tolerated.
Why are you
Somebody had to have a tough conversation. I didn't want to do it. I hope he can forgive me. But you know, stuff happens. You hear me? I had to approach him like a man and tell him, hey man, you got a job to do. I will get one of your other personalities to take over if you don't get your shit together. So, here we are. Ringtime Pro Wrestling, Keith and Keisha, in the building, talking about a wonderful week in wrestling.
I'm too silly for this. How do we get together over here? I'm over here crying.
Hey, man. Get real out here. These jobs ain't gonna be floating around all the time. Might be a recession soon. Who knows?
You all fire yourself, Keith. Like, look, I ain't got time for this.
Yeah, I ain't got time for your shit.
Your insubordination is killing me. I'm not dealing with it. Get stuff. Let's have security walk you out.
Right.
Happy to end of that. That's, you know what? That's terrible. That is a terrible way to go. Like, yeah. You come to work and your stuff sitting in a box at your desk, and they're like, yeah, so.
I'm going to tell you.
I have to let you go.
Every time I come into work and my bag start acting a little funny, I have went through the all-out panic that I've been fired. I took myself through unemployment and everything else in 10 minutes just off my badge not working right. And mind you, it might not work, and then it worked after like 5 seconds. You know what I mean? The fingerprint scanner janky as hell. But, you know what I'm saying? Every time it get a little funky with me, I'm like, shit, they with their bullshit. Don't let both happen at the same time or the same day. Then I have a little trouble logging in. And really, it was just me forgetting my password. Because we got to use a 14-character password now. Which I think is some bullshit. But neither here nor there.
Hey, man, look. All I can say is it happens at my job all the time. You folks be like, yeah, you know, what is it working? Yes, I'm supposed to. Yeah, go on and get that to whoever in front of you. Yeah, you can go. That'd be the end. You'd be like, what? Yeah.
Look, no. I understand firing somebody over the phone is impersonal. I work a good 35 to 40 minutes away from my job. Call me.
Nah.
Call me.
Let me tell you.
I ain't trying to waste that gas. Gas not going up too?
I used to work for a company that will let you work your last shift, and you won't even know it. Your ass will get off, you thinking, you know, yeah, you just going home now, bro. You know, this supervisor come up, walk up to you, yeah, before you leave, let me get that badge off of you. He'd be like, what? That's like, are you serious? Either that, or you've been unshowed all the way up, right? Thinking you finna work. Like, you finna sign in, and you finna just... No, yeah. We got somebody here for you. You give us a badge, and yeah, you can go home. Like, nigga, what? Like, and some people was driving, like, a whole 45 minutes, an hour, you know what I'm saying, to get there. You ain't finna... It's one thing I show up, and you don't let me work my shift. It's another when you let me work a whole 8 hours, sometimes 12, and then tell me I ain't got no job no more. Excuse me? Like, have you lost all your money? Like, no. See, that's why people go post that kind of stuff right there. Yeah, you better call me on the phone.
Yeah, I've seen the... Okay, so... I knew... Okay, there was one person I worked with, and I'm just, because I'm not naming the place, I'm not naming the people, so I guess I can get away with this. Keish, they knew good and damn well they was going to fire this girl. They was going to fire her because of something she did the day before, right?
Right, right.
She had an assignment. They said, no, don't go there. Come in here. And you know what? Come in early. We need you here. Let her... So she usually worked at like 11 or 12. They had her come in at 8. Uh-huh. Keisha, they let her work till 4 o'clock. And I mean, put in some good work that day, too. closed a bunch of calls. And then fired it at about 4 o'clock. I said, damn. They filled a shift on that ass. And still.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, damn, this is crazy. Seen it, man. I've seen it go rough. I've seen people fire themselves. I've seen people who... I mean, just craziness, man. The corporate world is crazy. Right. But, once again, we are off track because we can't even talk about wrestling. And we, yeah, I guess, okay. We, you know what? Talking about firing and people getting let go and crazy shit happening is going to lead us into probably the main topic and why we're here. So we're going to go through the whole gamut of wrestling, right? So, at present press time of recording of 11:50 p.m., June 29th, Fighter Fest just ended. Stomping Grounds happened a week ago. Raw and SmackDown happened. And boom, in the middle of the week, the wrestling world blew up because we find out that Eric Bischoff and Paul Heyman are back in the WWE. With jobs. First, it was broken by... So, the WWE, when they have big news, I notice what they do. They leak it to a news outlet so they can run... So they can run the story. So Sports Illustrated reported it. And sometimes they'll link it to ESPN or whatever. Really what they do, they link it to everybody. Whoever the biggest outlet that reports it first and get the buzz cracking. Because it only takes one reputable outlet to report something. Really, it doesn't even take a reputable outlet to report something. Right. The dirt sheets jump on it quick, right? All your favorite fan sites jump on it quick. Now, as most of you know who listen to the show, Ringtime Pro Wrestling has slacked in the hardcore journalism department. That is 100% my fault. Take the blame for it. Just understand I'm working through some shit. So, eventually the site will get back to its glory. Right? Eventually I will become the writer that I was 2 or 3 years ago. The reason why y'all come and listen to this show every week, I think, right? Because I think the writing back in the day, I thought that carried the brand of Ringtime Pro Wrestling. Mm-hmm. Whereas now, the show carries the brand. Because and the reason why the show carries this brand is because it's the thing that we do every single week without fail. Almost every single week, because there's some weeks we have fell off. But I say this to say, even then, I didn't jump on every single rumor or every single thing. But the rest of the site, I mean, because I follow a lot of, and I've been in a lot of groups on Facebook or whatever. And like soon as something like halfway breaks, everybody's on it. Everybody's an expert. Everybody knows. Everybody knows the contract situation. It's, and a lot of times they're right, which is crazy. Which I just think that's the companies just leaking information because, man, look, either that, well, I think this too, for whatever reason, because of the social media era, everybody wants to be famous, everybody wants to break something, so you can't even trust anybody who works anywhere. Like, if you want to, like, keep something and, like, really have a pop nowadays and really have, like, a secret, you got to keep it between, like, four people, right? Like, if you're in the WWE, you got to keep it between Triple H, Vince McMahon, and whoever the talent is. Like, to the point where you got to tell the other talent that, hey, this is going to happen like this. And tell them, like, at the show, like, look, we're going to change the finish of the match. Somebody's going to come out. I'm not even telling you who's coming out. When you see that person and the crowd pop, you know that guy's going over. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, it has to be that kind of thing. Because anything other than that, it's going to get leaked. You can't show up at an airport in the morning no more. Jericho found that out a few years ago. So, you got to private jet it or drive into town without nobody knowing. Like, it just got... And hope nobody catches it on a camera phone and still want to tell everybody. Because everybody is the media, too. And that's a thing. Which I know sounds hypocritical because, I mean... Who says I have the right to be? But it's just, I don't know. It's just weird.
Well, one, you're a living legend. So let's go ahead and put that out there now. And two, you ain't everybody else.
Yeah.
So there. I said it, and I meant it.
Well, I appreciate that. But like I said, I think they leaked this stuff to the major news outlets, whether it be Sports Illustrated, ESPN, and then they do something, and they call it, they like, yo, as reported. The WWE comes out and says, as reported by Sports Illustrated or ESPN, to confirm the thing. And it's like, y'all knew this was coming out anyway. Why don't y'all just do the... But I think they like that. The idea, like, hey, the world is buzzing already. So we'll let y'all tell. So we'll tell it to y'all. But apparently, yes, Paul and Eric are executive directors of Raw and SmackDown, respectively. Should I was going to say this for the news, but should we dissect that now and then go into the wrestling for the week? Or do we want to hold that
off? Need to just talk. We need to just go ahead and talk about this now, because this is too big of a story for us to wait until the news. Okay?
All right,
this
perfect.
Is how we need to start it off.
Because I figured, like, this is what's going to carry the show. This is why y'all came here this week.
Yeah, exactly. Like, all the rest of that stuff, they came for that too. But this right here... No, this is why everybody's listening to a wrestling vlog. Everybody's looking at the dirt sheets and the stories, and they trying to see if this is true. I'm pretty sure WWE's website and the network and everything else and got all kinds of hits, clicks, views, and everything else trying to figure out if this story is true. It is true, and all I'm saying is this is huge. Like, this is a bombshell. Like, this is a bombshell beyond bombshells, about bombshells, okay?
Right.
Like, there is nothing. I don't even know how to put it in words, like, how crazy this is right now. Because, I mean, we all see him, you know, when he comes on, you know, for Brock and all that kind of stuff, but, like, Bischoff? Whoa, you know, like, this what we doing right now?
Yeah, so here's the thing. This is what I would tell you. Crazy enough, this is not as uncommon as you think. And I say that to say, as a wrestler historian, if you look at the territories, every territory that ever fell off or something like that, they pulled in somebody, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, in the 80s, nobody competed harder with the WWF than WCW, a.k.a., you know, Jim Crockett Promotions. Well, the head of creative and all of that was Dusty Rhodes. WWF couldn't wait to get their hands on Dusty, right?
Right.
Different executives like J.J. Dillon and stuff like that have worked at every company, just about. Gary Hart had went around the world. Kevin Sullivan went around the world. Different people have worked in different capacities. Dutch Mantel has worked creative in a lot of different places in a lot of different territories. I'm just saying, it's not as uncommon as it seems. And, I mean, hell, Bischoff and Heyman have worked in WWE. Now, Bischoff has never had an executive role in WWF or WWE in his time. He was strictly talent. He was an on-air administrator, but he was strictly talent. Heyman has been behind the scenes, had a very contentious role behind the scenes. And I think that actually makes it more amazing that he's back, because him and Vince have found that they work well together, but they work well together and stress each other out immensely.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. At the same time. Now, I don't know what Bischoff and Vince, how they work together, that dynamic works.
Right.
Eric is in an interesting position, because I don't know if he knows how to work with Vince in this. And I don't know if Vince is going to let Eric have a certain level of freedom. But this is what I'll say. Both of these men have built great legacies in wrestling. Like, that's I will not take that away from either one of them. They've also tanked their own companies individually, right? Like, let's not shy away from that. ECW went down in flames. WCW went down in flames, even though WCW, I could argue, they were doomed towards the end, not because they couldn't be saved, but because the people who owned the company didn't want to deal with wrestling anymore. The power brokers within that structure never really wanted it. One guy who owned it all wanted it. He was no longer in charge and no longer owned it. You know what I mean? And right. Then things changed. So, yeah. That's all that happened. But I am interested to see how Bischoff and Vince work together. Will Paul... Because there's so many dynamics at play, right? Right. How does Triple H make all that work, right? Because what is his role in it? Because I think a lot of people expected something like this to work for him. But Triple H's key job is executive director of talent relations. Like, he's the vice president of talent relations. He's the one who picks out the talent. He's the one who signs everybody and then develops them. And then when they get ready for Raw or SmackDown, you know, it is what it is. So I don't think he could have done either one of these roles. I think both of these roles will require a full-time person. They're gearing up for a big fight because they are ready for whatever turns out of AEW. Wrestling as hot as it's ever been, despite the rating slips. And I don't overreact to ratings because I don't even know if ratings mean in 2019 what they meant in 1999. And I think that just has to be a paradigm shift, right?
Right.
Because in wrestling, there's different things that have been the focus over time. So when I was a kid, the live show still was the most important thing.
Right.
And then the pay-per-view came along. But the live show still probably was number. The idea was to get butts in the seats, get people right. to come out to those arenas and buy tickets. Then you flipped it on to the pay-per-view. How do you build? Because the pay-per-view was a good way to generate the most income. So that big show that they was building to, well, now it's a pay-per-view. So not just people in a territory can see it, but everybody around the world can see it. So that's where it came to. Well, late 90s, because the TV war became so hot, everything was about the television and getting the television ratings, which was cool because then when the networks came in with these big money contracts, that altered the game. Pay-per-views were still important, but the main thing was the television ratings. All right, fast forward to 2019. Everybody has a network that provides a subscription, right?
Right.
I think that matters. But then there's still the pay-per-views. Not pay-per-views. The pay-per-views are less important. But it's now the television ratings are still heavy because there's so much money being thrown. Like, the reason the stock price is up on WWE is because of this Fox deal for SmackDown. So, I mean, there's a lot of stress there. But somebody going to have to calibrate because TV ratings aren't just, they don't mean the same thing. One, the way they're calculated is so fucking antiquated, right? Like the Nielsen rating system. Do you know how that works?
I do.
Okay. But for the benefit of those who don't know, this is how it goes. You have, so in your neighborhood, have you ever met a Nielsen family? Have you ever been to a house and seen a Nielsen box?
No.
Guess what? Keish, I'll be 40 this year. Never been to a house that had a Nielsen box, right?
Right.
I reached out to Nielsen, and they were like, no, you can't apply to this. we just randomly select people and you get the box, right? And if you decide to participate, right, you participate. So basically, they have sent out boxes to random people. They try to control the demographics or something to an extent because they want, they want to have that data, right? And I'm not saying it's not, because this is how studies are done, right? Anybody who's ever done research or anything like that, when they tell you a percentage of families do this, a percentage of families do that, basically, they polled 1,000 people, got the demo information from that 1,000 people, and then extrapolated to the society. Right? It's kind of how TV ratings work. They send these boxes in. Like, people don't, they don't necessarily know what you're watching, except for people who use different digital platforms, because that's different. But for the most part, they send the boxes to your house. You watch a TV. You hit the button on the box, like, hey, or your remote, like, bam, I'm watching BET Awards. All right. That check mark goes for BET Awards, right? So I know this family, this African-American family in Atlanta that has four people in it, you know, da-da-da-da. They're watching the BET Awards. Mark that off. I know somebody watching a rerun of Seinfeld. Mark that off. All right, cool. They tabulate that data and once again extrapolate it to the rest of society, and they give you an idea what a rate it is. And from there, they estimate that, hey, 8 million people was watching this show at this time. 4 million people was watching this show at this time. I will say this. I think it's antiquated. And because people don't watch TV the way they used to, I don't know how people are live sitting in front of a television anymore.
Right.
Like, Lynn don't have a, she have a TV in her room, but she, everything, her TV is connected to internet devices that she streams stuff. Where do those numbers go? You know what I mean?
Right.
And rarely does she watch live TV anymore. And I'm saying that because I'm speaking to somebody who is the future. I know you.
It's true.
You rarely watch Raw or SmackDown live, but you watch them every week.
Right.
Right? Through Hulu.
Thanks to Hulu.
Who has those numbers? You know what I'm saying? So what I'm saying is TV ratings, I don't necessarily think are the way, but it's I guess it's the thing that they have right now. But network subscriptions are going to matter because that's something tangible, right? And regardless to how many people are actually streaming, really doesn't matter. It's just the number of subscriptions. And what I mean by that, because one, people share logins, so that's hard to track. And some people watch and don't watch. But hey, do you really care if they're watching if they still not, if they're not canceling? Like, I have a Planet Fitness subscription, not subscription, but you know, I pay them every month.
Yeah, right.
Last month, I just basically paid a fat tax. That $20 was a fat tax because I didn't go. So I'm not utilizing it, but they got their money. They get their money regardless whether I work out or not. I'm only cheating myself. You know what I mean? That's why I say it's a fat tax, because my fat ass basically said, here's the money. I ain't coming, but hey, y'all get it anyway. That's a tax for just being fat and lazy. Okay, cool. If you got the network, and a lot of people have a lot of subscriptions that they don't even use actively. I pay New Japan every month, and I've made a conscious effort to log on a little bit more, but anyway, most of the time I only go for the big events. I'm actually paying them for the convenience of just, hey, when something happens, I have it. Right?
Right.
If I heard that there was a big match last night, I could pull it up and stream it. That's all. Like, I'm not really, you know, and I ain't got to dig around YouTube or nothing.
Look, I have subscription for Netflix, Hulu, the WWE Network, Apple Music, DC Universe, URL, which is a battle rap. They have an app now, so I subscribe to that. Amazon Prime, and I'm forgetting something. I know I am, and it's not going to come to me till later. But anyway, yeah, so I stream it from all of that. I can guarantee you, out of all those apps I just named, I usually use, like, three on a regular basis. The rest of them, like, friends have logins for, and, you know, all that shit. Like, it's just the convenience of it. You know what I'm saying? Like, if I ain't can't find it here, I can find it there. If vice versa, you know, whatever. But I think that there has to be a way to... Actually, you know what? I think that some streaming services actually do something that's similar to... I know Netflix does. They do something similar to, like, the Nelson box. From my understanding, they definitely hire people to, like, stream from their service, and they watch, like, different shows, and they give it ratings, and they, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And it's not necessarily giving ratings, like, as far as, like, how the Nelson box measures ratings for live television, but... it's to get a sense of, you know, is this good, is this bad, you know, what kind of content should they put up on their next? Are we going in the right direction? Should we be served somewhere else with this? Like, it definitely has become, there's become ways that people can, that gets said that different companies can measure these things, which can control what kind of content they need to be adding or subtracting from their particular streaming services. I know if you have, like, oh, I forgot, like, you have a way for you to watch live TV. They have their streaming service where you can watch live TV, and Hulu does too. And then there's things like Sling TV, and, you know, Xfinity actually has the Xfinity On The Go app so that you can watch live TV from anywhere, you know. Yeah. And then there's, like, yeah, so, I mean, they create, I guess, in a sense, some companies knew, okay, people are streaming more than they are sitting at home watching live TV. Let's create a way for them to watch live TV, but not be at home, or, you know, not have to worry about paying a cable bill, per se, when they can just pay for the streaming service. If I have Sling TV, then I can watch live TV, and I pay $20 a month for it. You know what I'm saying? If I have Hulu Live, it's like the same. I think it's about like $39, $40 or something like that. But, like, compared to the regular cable bill, you know, that's nothing. And then, of course, you already, all you need to do is hook it up to the Wi-Fi or whatever, and then you can stream it from anywhere. All you gotta do is download the app. So, and I know some of them are available on, like, Fire Sticks and Roku's and, you know, smart TVs and all that kind of stuff. So, they try to figure out, I think some companies have figured out ways to get people to watch live TV and to generate ratings. And I feel like there's so many companies, they are paid by, like, the TV stations and that kind of stuff, you know, so that they can push ratings. If I can get you to watch this on live TV and you're at work, you know, on your computer or you're on your phone or whatever, then I still got you to watch this live. So yeah. I can still generate ratings for my network or my show or whatever, you know. And I think that to me is how they push live TV into the future. Because, you know, sitting at home watching TV is not a thing anymore, really.
Right.
You know, not too many people do that. I when I'm at home, well, yeah, like,
yeah. And that's,
you know,
the thing.
At home, you know, there's TV there. It's not, I don't even turn it on.
Right.
When I'm watching YouTube videos and stuff on my phone, I don't
TV. Here's the thing. So, I don't want to bury live TV either, right? So, just like terrestrial radio, a lot of people are into podcasts and different things like that. They don't listen to terrestrial radio anymore, mm-hmm. but I think terrestrial radio still it's probably the most popular medium of radio for people when they go in a car. So I would say live TV is probably going to be still the same thing, because doing these other things we talk about requires some work. Just turn to the channel that is already on requires no work. So it's still going to be the most popular medium, per se. Now, like I said, to bring this all back in, how is this going to work? So let's take Raw, right? Heyman's going to be at Raw instead of SmackDown, which a lot of people were shocked because people remember his most successful time was running SmackDown.
Oh, yeah.
But because of his time with the company and because of trust, I think they trust him with the flagship, right? Which will be Raw. Also, Brock is doing Raw. Heyman got to be where Brock is at. Period, point blank. Now, will Brock come to SmackDown sometime? I would stand to believe so, because Fox is going to demand punches. They're going to demand star power because they're heavily invested in this. This means a lot to them. Okay. They really want this to work, and they got a lot of input. They putting up a lot of money. Raw is going to be interesting, because Raw, like I said, has always been the flagship. It's always been the most important thing to Vince, right? And this is one of the reasons why Heyman is there. Will he let Heyman have Heyman control and run things? Or will he still battle him on things? Because Vince still likes to do Vince things. How is the writing staff going to be managed? Will they let the guys run freer on the promos? Because got to remember, too, this is still a publicly traded company, so certain things cannot happen. They cannot run into certain things that might, you know, damage that. So they don't. Stock prices are fickle, man, and investors are fickle. So you do not need that price dropping because of some bull. Vince is like, he's went from like kind of a billionaire to a very secure billionaire. You know what I mean? Like, Vince went from like being like, oh man, he might be worth a billion, then it falls down to about 800 million, then it's at a billion, to like now, he's worth like 2 or 3 billion. You know what I mean? Like, the game done changed. And this is why. And also, so all these competing things are happening. With the XFL popping off, is Vince going to let Bischoff and Heyman both have a little freer reign, right? Now, strange enough, as much as Vince has always hovered over Raw, because kind of the way Heyman got away with a lot of things on SmackDown was Vince used to leave SmackDown alone because he was heavier on Raw. And you could just kind of do what you want, and then, you know, if something went out of control, then he'd come over to SmackDown. Now, there were some things, too, because Stephanie was just coming up and she was trying to learn, so then there were some things with that, too. We're in a totally different place now. I want to see if he lets Heyman run Raw. And I wonder if he lets them both, because I think he wants them to compete, because both of them want to prove, like, hey, I can run the hell out of a wrestling company. So, does he let Heyman be Heyman? How has Heyman's ideas evolved 15 years later? Right? Like, I'm very interested in that. How does he see the current product and the current roster? Bischoff, how has his ideas evolved 17, 18 years later? How does he see the current roster? Right?
Right.
Will these guys' deficiencies be helped by they still have to go through the lens of Vince McMahon? All of that is interesting. Also, because of the Fox deal, I think, will Bischoff have more scrutiny on him, because that's where the most money is coming in, right? Like, it's a business, so the thing that makes the most money is going to get the most attention. One of the reasons people said they like Bischoff to be on SmackDown, because they said Fox said they wanted Heyman, but the WWE felt like, this is the word on the street, don't know how true this is, Bischoff has more experience dealing with major networks, than Paul. Paul's dealt with cable, stuff like that. ECW had a deal with TNN, which basically TNN, which became Spike TV, which is now like Paramount or something like that, basically just kind of used them as an audition to get Raw. Right. That's all that they did with ECW. Bischoff has a long-standing thing because he worked with Turner. Right, he worked at Turner, so that's huge. And it'll give you bigger insight. And Bischoff, for those who don't know, has been producing TV shows with Jason Hervey, his partner, the older brother from the Wonder Years, for some of you older people, for a long time. And that's so he's pitching and he knows how to go into network meetings and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So that experience, I think, is what they felt led him to be able to handle SmackDown. All in all, the 90s, I'm not sure the 90s are back, because I've seen that around, right? And there's been a lot of jokes made, because, hey, Bischoff and Heyman are back in prominent wrestling positions. Aladdin is in the movies. Right. The Lion King coming out. Toy Story. It's like Men in Black is at the movies. Like, hell, is this 1997?
Right.
No.
Exactly.
Here's the thing. I don't know. I love the Attitude Era, right? It's one of my favorite times of wrestling. But one of the things I'm grateful for being the age I am, I've seen a lot of different eras of wrestling. And as much as I like the nostalgia of it, I've not really ever clamored for it to be back in full force every day of my life, right? Because there's some people who have, since 2002, have clamored to get it back to that point. And I don't think people understand what happened during the Attitude Era. Old school guys say it in a way, they hotshotted the territories. Hotshot is when you throw everything at it because what you're trying to do is blow up, right? Well, some guys used to do when they hotshot the territory, like they brought in all these guys, they would do this, they would bring in Dusty and Andre and all that, and they would spend all this money, and boom, they would get these big sellouts at like the Omni or something like that, and then when the territory blew up, they'd sell the territory. Right, and the next guy thinking like, "Shit, we about to be paid?" Nah, because you can't keep up at that pace. Because even if you would, after a while, the people get desensitized.
Right,
the Attitude Era desensitized people. That's why y'all got used to seeing the champion wrestle on TV every week, and it don't seem special anymore because that's what they needed during the Attitude Era. So both companies had the biggest stars in the world on TV every single week. And you got to retrain the wrestler fan, I think, a little bit. But everybody's still trying to do that. Everybody's still trying to have a heel authority figure, all that stuff. Some of it just is, you know, I like NXT. I'm a real big NXT fan. And you know why I like NXT? Because it's the closest thing that resembles classic wrestling. And you know what you don't see every week? You don't see the champ every week. You don't even see the same guys every week. In an hour-long show, they figure out a way to manage the talent in a way where you don't really fall off or hate anybody, or you don't miss anybody too much. But through it all, everybody still remains relevant, right? You don't have to see everybody every single week and to make it all work. Now, to appease corporate sponsors and stuff like that, I understand there's some complications. But I'm very interested to see how it all turns out, but I'm not like expecting it all to be 1998 again and these things to show up a certain way.
And here's the thing. I mean, I just don't Okay, I'm 32, and I can say honestly, like, I know that only WWE, as we all know, is a publicly traded company, and Vince likes control. Like, let's just end all and be all. He likes control. But I feel like with the hiring of Heyman and Bischoff, like, I feel he'll still have a hand in it, but I think he hired two men that he feel like he can trust to run these shows without having to have, like, control. You know? I feel like he entrusted these two big things with two men that he feels like can take them in the direction that they need to go to with what they're going to do moving forward. And, like, I don't see... I love the Attitude Era because that's how I grew up into wrestling. So I'm not going to sit here at the same time. I'm not rooting for it to return. You know, there was the things that you described about it. People were getting legitimately hurt in the Attitude Era. And we're not just talking about, like, tore an ACL or what. No, like, whew, shit, okay? These were, like, legit injuries, like concussions and just, you know, things that were done on purpose. You know, it wasn't like, oh, I'm going to give you a concussion, but chair shot to the head can do that. You know what I'm saying? Like, throwing yourself, you know, off tables and through off ladders and, you know, just these people were hurt, you know? And the Attitude Era brought a level of wrestling in my eyes that was very extreme, very violent. They're not going to return to that. Especially because with it being publicly traded, sponsors and, you know, companies that invest in the WWE and all that kind of stuff, they don't want to see that shit. Like, I don't know if not too many of you, but Keith, I know you do. Like, they were losing sponsors during the Attitude Era. Like, people were like, no. Especially when they got to, like, a TVMA rating on Raw. Like, they were like, nah, we good. Like, people were just, there were companies that were just walking away. Like, nah, I'm good on that. Like, we don't want no parts of this. So, I know that's not going to happen. But I do feel like Heyman and Bischoff will take both shows into sort of a different direction, you know? And I know Triple H will be around, and I know, of course, Vince will be around as well. But I don't feel as if we're just going to see what they want through the eyes of Heyman and Bischoff. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like you'll see a lot more of them incorporated into the shows to mold them into what the networks want and what they want at the same time. I don't see it necessarily being what it is right now, you know. I definitely see the changes coming, short changes in the storyline. Things might get a little rough, but it won't get extreme, you know. They'll still be able to keep the PG rating, but still, you know, spice it up or you know, whatever they need to do in order to keep the ratings up, keep people watching. Get them back to live TV again. You know what I'm saying? He leaves not only the wrestling fans of today, but the ones like us that's been watching for forever. You know what I'm saying? I think this is just, I think it's a huge move for the company itself with Heyman and Bischoff. Like, I ain't gonna lie. I'm pretty sure not too many people, if anybody at all, seen this shit coming. Like, this is not something that you just talk about on a regular day. Like, yeah, you know, I think that Heyman and Bischoff should run Raw and SmackDown. Like, nobody is sitting here talking about this shit. Like, this is just insane, Keith. This is insane. But I support it, you know, at first, I was just shocked. But now, you know, especially in the last, ever since they made the announcement, really, I had time to think about it, and I really am looking forward to what they are going to do. But I'm also looking forward to see, like, how much involvement Vince and H have and everything, because of the simple fact that these are the executive directors of these two shows. So I want to know if they're going to let them just run it, you know, like kind of like how Triple H, you know, has his hand and, you know, he runs NXT. So I wonder if they're going to let them do the same thing with Raw and SmackDown. Or is it just going to be like Vince coming in and be like, yeah, that's cool, but we need to change this. You know what I'm saying? And I know that with Heyman, that's definitely something that they're going to bump heads on. But it's, I just wonder, like, how much of what we have now is going to be preserved and how much of it is going to change. And I guess we'll find out after they officially, are they officially taking their roles now? Or is this fight going to happen later?
Here's the thing. They said, they say Bischoff should show up on SmackDown pretty soon. I don't know how soon the roles are going to be in place, or if they've been in place and we are just now hearing about it, right? So,
right.
I would think the transition should take a little bit of time because this is big. And I think a lot of things with Bischoff probably is happening behind the scenes because they've got to get ready. And I think they want to hit the ground running. The way the current storylines are in place, I'm going to say that neither one of these guys are in charge right now. Because the way the stories are fitting don't fit either one of them. So, that'll be that. Would it be an hour into the show? We're going to pivot. Going to talk Stomping Grounds. Then we'll come back. I'm going to hit the break. We'll come back. We'll do Raw SmackDown. We'll change the order up a little bit. So if you're following by the notes, don't worry about it. But right now, we're going to hit the break and we'll be back.
Hours of World Championship Wrestling. We're going to leave you today with a look at NWA Television Champion, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, on the night that he won the NWA Television title. For David Crockett, I'm Tony Schiavone. We'll see you next time on World Championship Wrestling.
Just moments ago, Dusty Rhodes became the new National Wrestling Alliance Television Champion. And before he gets away, we want to have a few words with him. Congratulations, Dusty. It was a great win.
You know, I think throughout this country of our land that we live in, let me tell you something. Whether you like Ric Flair, Dusty Rhodes or not, I want to tell you, this is what it's all about. Only Ric Flair and Dusty Rhodes travel in style, live in style, and are the greatest two professional athletes in wrestling today. Bar none. Go all over the world. Pay whoever you want to pay to walk alongside of you. Pay whoever you want to pay to stand beside you and put your paper on newsstands all over the world. It boils down to the National Wrestling Alliance. It boils down to limousines, silver screens, Ric Flair, Dusty Rhodes, and now the new National Wrestling Alliance Television Champion. And like I said before, style is what you make it. We live. Nobody lived this way. Nobody has crystal glass in the backseat of the Chevrolet, Jack. Nobody sups from my cup but the American Dream. And Ricky, somewhere down the road, that world title gonna be me and yours again. But for now, I just want the world to know if there's any better anywhere, I'd like to see them, baby. I'd like to know who they were. NWA Television Champion Tony Schiavone, I'll defend it all over the world because the National Wrestling Alliance goes all over the world and the greatest promoter in the world is Jim Crockett Promotions. And I'm so happy. I tell it like it is. Talking's over. I got to go party down, man.
That's it from our new NWA Television Champion, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes.
Okay. I don't understand why I let that promo. You know, the funny thing is, I'm looking at the time. I'm like, I got time left on this. Why is it doing this? I don't know. Probably shouldn't worry about it. Mm-mm. Okay. Make sure I turn the mics on, too. Because I turned the mics off during the promos and stuff like that. And I'm like, did I turn the mic back? Because, you know, I done sat here and talked for like 20 minutes and the mic just ain't been back on. But, anyway. I digress. Stomping grounds, Keshia. Last Sunday. I think the first stomping grounds that we've ever had. I kind of counted it as a throwaway pay-per-view, but it held its own. It did what it was supposed to do.
True.
So, that's fair enough. So, we're going to go down the line, and we'll talk the matches, and then, you know, everybody had an opinion. Drew Gulak won the Cruiserweight title, defeating Tony Nese and Akira Tozawa. Now, I told you, I always suck at those predictions for 205 Live because I don't watch it.
All right.
It's kind of like if you telling me stuff is cracking on Main Event, I'm like, I guess so.
Wait, Main Event is still a show?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I gotta get back on Hulu.
Matter of fact, Main Event, they try to have a stable. Bobby Roode, Cesaro, and EC3, they say gonna be a stable over on Main Event. I forgot what they gonna call themselves, Main Event something.
What?
Yeah, because really what it is that they all should be cracking on Raw and SmackDown, but because, you know, stuff.
Yeah.
People not knowing how to use talent. Which,
right,
part of with the new executive directors. We'll see if somebody's able to, because here's the thing. I think both of those guys want to have talent that they've kind of said they cultivated. So it would be interesting to see if they take some people who they haven't been used much and make it pop. Especially since those guys have experience with some of those guys, right? Like, Bischoff knows Bobby Roode. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Bischoff knows EC3. Because he's worked at TNA. Maybe he like, shoot, I could really make this guy pop. Or maybe not. We'll see. But, yeah. So, yeah, like I said, I don't watch 205 Live. Becky Lynch defeated Lacey Evans by a submission to retain the Raw Women's title. No surprise there.
Yeah, nah, I wasn't. It was a good match, though.
Yeah.
I will give it that.
Here's the thing. I'm interested to see what happens with Lacey after this, right? Yeah. So, I've told you this about the men and the women on the roster. The WWE seems to struggle when they're not dealing with somebody in the main event. And I don't know what their plan is for these people.
No,
not they're not in the main event.
Right. Well, I know one thing that happens to them is they can go from being in the main event to not being seen on TV at all. And then it's like, wait a minute, when this person just in the main event wrestling for the title like all of like 3 weeks ago? And then you don't hear their name, you don't see their face, nothing. And then, like, randomly another month later, they come wrestle for a match, whatever. They just get in the background somewhere. And then they randomly get thrown into a storyline somewhere down the line for, like, a mid-tier title if they're a man. Or if, you know, if they're a woman, they just get thrown into some random storyline that's just seen during, you know, in between matches and all this kind of shit. It's ridiculous, okay? Personally, I don't know what the writers be going through when they make up the story, when they go through the storylines for the wrestlers, because, you know, they get so random. They get so random sometimes, and it's just kind of like, what is this? You know what I'm saying? Because they'll go from You know, Lacey Evans could be hot right now, you know, facing Becky Lynch. But then, like, after the next pay-per-view, you know what I'm saying, she'd be somebody's manager, you know, walking out with, like, Bobby Lashley or something. You know, it just don't make sense. In my mind, it's stuff that they do at times really just don't add up, and I hope that the new directors can clear this up and change this, because it's a lot that just is confusing. And then, you know, stuff starts to become a little predictable, almost. I do wonder also what they're going to do with Lacey Evans after they finish this whole thing with her and Becky. But at the same time, it's like, y'all blew her up so fast. And that is the biggest problem that they have with some of the people they bring in from NXT, is they put them at the top and then they have no place to come but down. Like, somebody like Becky had to fight her way, you know, like, she was the first SmackDown Women's Champion. And then she didn't win the SmackDown Women's title again until she turned heel and beat Charlotte. So it's like, you know, that kind of stuff is what I'm talking about. Like, but she had to fight her way to that point. You know what I'm saying? Like, and then you have somebody like Lacey who comes in, she's random, and then all of a sudden she's having women's title matches, and it's like, what do you do with her from that point? Because she has nowhere to go but down. You know, if she's not even the belt, she doesn't have any other direction to go. So, you know, if she ends up getting faded into the background with some of the other women's wrestlers that's not on there every week, and it's frustrating. It's frustrating. And I'm trying not to be annoyed, but it's like, this is ridiculous. You know what I'm saying? Because wrestlers can be utilized way better than that. You know, it's like, it's way better than me. But I'm going to get off my soapbox, because I could go on this for this for, like, ever. I could do this forever. But, you know, to make, to shorten out what I was talking about, like, you know, I hope that with Lacey, they don't just, you know, toss her to the side and then we just don't see her much anymore. You know what I'm saying? Like, she can be way better. If anything, she can be, since they have this whole wild card thing, like, she can be going back and forth between Raw and SmackDown. Like, she can, they can find something for her. You know what I'm saying?
Well, no, I hope the Raw thing goes, I mean, I hope the wild card thing goes away. And
yeah,
I'll tell you why. It doesn't have any rhyme or reason. And they're not utilizing the talent, to me, in a way that maximizes them. Right. Doing the wild card. So that's my that. But back to Stomping Grounds. KO and Sami Zayn defeat the New Day. Didn't really call that one, but it makes sense. I mean, the New Day can't just run roughshod over it all, right? I thought it made KO look strong. And I mean, that lineup with Xavier and Big E, I think they have to tweak it anyway, because generally the A lineup of New Day was Xavier and Kofi. I mean, not Xavier and Kofi, I'm sorry. Kofi and Big E. So now this Xavier and Big E, it'll be a little bit of a learning curve, right? Ricochet defeated Samoa Joe. I did not call that, Keish. I did not have that.
No. But I did. Ha ha. Yeah, call me. Let me chill out. I was hoping that this would be the outcome. I was excited. That was a good match too, by the way. Like, I was thoroughly impressed. Like, man, what? Because I guess, but you know what? I feel like, you know, Samoa Joe is being underutilized anyway. So I think this is a good way to kind of bring him back into the fold and give Ricochet his shine with this new title. So I feel like it was a win-win for the both of them, you know? Hopefully that's the case, and I'm not just talking shit, you know? But that's how I see this, you know? I'm happy. I was excited about that. That particular stuff. So, you know, it is what it is. Go Ricochet.
Yeah, here's the thing. Based on what I've seen on the last few shows from them, yeah, I mean, this is not a feud. This is kind of a one and done. I guess they want to see what they have in Ricochet. So the best way to figure it out is to put a strap on him and see if he can carry it. We've already talked about, I think he's a real life superhero. So we'll see what they get out of that. Like, I think as people who try to build a TV show, he's definitely good for television. Daniel Bryan and Rowan beat Heavy Machinery. Kind of knew that was going to happen. But I will say this. It was a much better match than I gave it credit, that I was going to give it credit for. It, or the possibility of it being. Like,
that match was awesome.
I was like, oh, okay, this is pretty damn good. Like,
right. Mm-hmm. I agree.
Okay.
That match had a lot going on, but it was good, though. It was good.
So, yeah. Bayley defeated Alexa Bliss, which I thought was a good match. And I thought it was good to see Bayley come out on top. Now, there's the thing right. Where Nikki Cross screws things up. But, hey, you know, that's part of an ongoing storyline that we'll see going forward. Roman Reigns defeated Drew McIntyre. We kind of knew that was going to happen. It's unfortunate for Drew because I think Drew is in a weird spot. Like, it's a good spot because it's a prominent spot, but he's got to take some losses, and I don't think that's cool. Like, I think this is a guy who could be one of your future pillars.
This is my thing with Drew. Okay. Drew left WWE because, you know, he wasn't being used right.
No, I mean, they released him. They didn't.
Yeah.
They thought he just wasn't what they thought they bought.
Yeah, so he was gone, right? And then he went into the indies and, like, completely revolutionized himself. And then he ends up on NXT. Now, when he was in NXT, he was dope. You know what I'm saying? Like, I can't lie. I was like, boy, this is not the Drew McIntyre that I remember. And so when he got brought back to the main roster, I was like, okay, maybe this time around, things will change. You know what I'm saying? And he can be seen as more than just the Intercontinental type. You know, the Intercontinental champion. And I feel like right now, you're just throwing... Ever since he's been brought back to the main roster, he's pretty much been in this whole bodyguard role. You know what I'm saying? Because first he was with Dolph, and then now he's with Shane. And it's kind of like, can we not do that with him? You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't think Drew is more than somebody's sidekick. You know what I'm saying? Like, he's more than just, like, the bodyguard role, you know? And I think they can do way better with him at this point. Now I feel like he is being underutilized. You know what I'm saying? Like, first you fired him because you couldn't figure out what to do with him. Now you have him back, and this is what happens. It's like, what was the point? You know? But he ends up in that place that most of the NXT guys end up in when they make it to the main roster, and it's kind of terrible. And I don't really like where he's at right now. I will say this because I don't want it to seem like, you know, oh, they need to get him off TV.
I'm glad that he's on TV every week.
You know what I'm saying? I'm glad that he gets TV time, and, you know, we see his face, and he wrestles in matches and everything. I am so glad that that is actually happening for him, but I feel like, you know, there could be more that could be done with him, because his potential is there. Everything's there for Drew, and I think they need to go ahead, break him apart from Shane, and give him, you know, the space and opportunity to really, you know, do what he was here, he was brought back here to do. So, that's my whole frustration with this whole Drew thing.
Yeah.
I'm a big Drew fan. I can't help it. Like, I feel like the repackaging of Drew McIntyre has definitely been successful for him. And he's definitely been, you know, living up to the hype. But it's just...
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. You know, I thought his rebuild of TNA was amazing. I thought he was the least interested NXT champion I've seen in a long time. But he came to the main roster and off to the races, right? Now it's just kind of like, I don't know. Kofi Kingston defeats Dolph Ziggler, steel cage match. Solid match, solid performers, but I don't know. I haven't been invested in it because I just don't think Dolph is going to do anything with this. But
yeah. That look. Can we talk about that dive out of the cage to the floor?
Yeah.
Like, I was feeling. I really was. I was fearing for his neck. Like, I was like, he's going to die. Like, y'all, why would y'all let him do this? Like, Kofi, you can't be dabbing like that. What is wrong with you?
Yeah, I mean, it's part of the Kofi experience, but it's also like, hey, man, this might be a little too dangerous.
Right.
But glad everything turned out okay. And everything worked out. So, Seth Rollins defeated Baron Corbin. Special guest referee was Lacey Evans, which we are have now officially went to the part where they are going to exploit their relationship. And I don't mean Beth and Seth, Becky and Seth. I mean the WWE, because hey, we can't have superstars who are in relationships without putting it into the story.
No. You know what? This is why I kind of disagree. If Becky and Seth weren't the champions of Raw, we wouldn't have this going on. Like, I feel like if Becky was not women's champion right now, this would not be happening. But the fact that the Universal Champion and the Raw Women's Champion are dating, then they're like, oh no, we need to milk this dry. And I'm like, no, you don't. Like, this is going to go left already. You know what I'm saying? Because it's not like they're in the ring and they, like, kiss on each other and all baby and all that stuff. But at the same time, like, everybody's fully aware that they're dating. Because, you know, you don't see that with Charlotte and Andrade. Like, you know, they ain't all flat and all over TV every week. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't see that with Naomi and the Oof. You know, it's like, come on, man.
But you did for a while. That became a part of the thing. Remember, that became a part of the whole Mandy Rose thing. That became a part of the thing with Miz. That, like, it shows up.
Now, they haven't gotten to, like I said, they ain't got to the Shadows and Andrade's. And I don't know if they're going to go that route. But at the same time, they love to take a relationship and be like, hey, y'all together, so this is what we're going to do. And it's like, no. Like, some stuff you just need to leave alone, okay? Some stuff you need to just let it be. But like I said, I really honestly feel like if neither one of them were holding the belts right now, we would have it going on, but it wouldn't be to this extent. You know what I'm saying? Like, it wouldn't have happened this fast. Like, they literally just announced to the world that they're dating, what, like 3 weeks ago? 4 weeks ago? Yeah, I don't even think it's been a month yet. And already we have a full-fledged storyline with them in.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So.
Just kind of weird, but. Yeah, I don't know, Keish. It just, for me, I'm like, it doesn't need to be there. And I feel like they wedged it in. But hey, moving on to Raw, because we just go run down the line. Apparently, Baron Corbin and Lacey Evans are going to team up now. And they're going to face Rollins and Becky Lynch at Extreme Rules in a winner-take-all match for all the belts.
All right.
I don't think the belts are going to change hands.
They're not.
But, so y'all going to do co-ed match at Extreme Rules?
Yes.
That's what we doing?
All right.
How extreme can you get in a co-ed match?
You can't. Like, this ain't.
I feel bad for Paul. Paul got to work at a company that's bastardizing the legacy. And I hate Extreme Rules, right?
Yeah, it's terrible. It's terrible. You know what? No. I would have liked Extreme Rules if this was 2000. You know what I'm saying? Like,
no.
If this was 1999, like, here's the thing. All for it.
I think they took something. See, something works at the WWE. And then they take it and just keep running it to the ground. So,
yeah.
2005, ECW One Night Stand was an incredible idea. They came back and did it again, and it still worked. Then they just start draining it and draining it and draining it. And that's how you got to Extreme Rules. And it's just like, and then they're going to make every stupid match that they can come up with. Like, mm-hmm. This is going to be an Extreme Rules match. This was going to be a no DQ. Because guess what? Keisha, it's all the fucking same because you can't get disqualified. But I digress. It's kind of like when they do TLC and they're like, all right, we're going to do the TLC match. Then we're going to do a tables match, a ladder match.
Just about to bring that up.
And then we're going to do a chairs match because there's never been a chairs match. Like, it's stupid. Basically, you just tell me I get to swing chairs.
And honestly, in my opinion, the worst has been Hell in a Cell. Because Hell in a Cell, it was a staple. You know, it was like the staple of matches. Like, you couldn't get... Hell in a Cell was scary. It was terrifying. You know what I'm saying? Like, people hear Hell in a Cell, and they're like, ah! You know, it's like, oh, okay. You know, like, because it ain't nothing but it's like a huge cage match. To people, you know, this ain't Hell in a Cell like we remember it, you know what I'm saying, where it happened like every blue moon and you know you only seen it maybe twice a year. If that, no, like,
yeah, no, yeah. No, actually, you never saw it.
You out of it.
There had been like 5 Hell in a Cell matches over like a 10-year period, right?
Exactly.
Then it's like now there's been like 30 in a 2-year period. Like, I don't know, it's just
right. It's terrible. It is terrible, Keith. It's terrible.
You can't even make a storyline out of it, right? So it's like, they're basically like, yo, they showing up and they wrestling Hell in a Cell. And it's like...
I tell you one better. Money in a Bank was a wonderful idea for WrestleMania. It was a wonderful idea for WrestleMania. I felt like that was one of the greatest things they ever came up with for WrestleMania. And then they decided to make it its own separate pay-per-view. And I was like, no, why are we doing this? What was the point? You know what I'm saying? Because now, like, the Money in the Bank pay-per-view isn't special to me. It's not. It's not special at all. Had you just kept those matches, all you had to do was create a Women's Money in the Bank, add it to WrestleMania. That is it. Because you already had WrestleMania like 5 hours long anyway, and that's without the kickoff show, okay? So why would you take this and make it its own pay-per-view? That is ridiculous. No. Then you have, 19 pay-per-views a year? It's only 12 months in a year. What are we doing here? Like, so, Stomping Grounds, Extreme Rules, the majority of stuff y'all can get rid of. You really could. Like, because there's no time for build up of the storyline and this, that, and it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Like, I personally just don't understand, like, what made them decide this was okay.
Yeah.
I don't.
But, you know. Let's see. R-Truth defeats Drake Maverick. R-Truth also has a few times where he gets the 24/7 title back at the end of the show after losing it a couple times. You know, it's just a bit crazy. So, highlights from Raw. Just go do the highlights.
Okay.
Roman Reigns was in a match, a handicap match with Drew McIntyre and Shane McMahon, which was going left until The Undertaker showed up. Which I was legitimately shocked. But then I wasn't. Like, I was like, you know what? I wonder if The Undertaker would show up. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know why I thought that, but right. Somehow it did happen.
You conjured him up, didn't you, Keith?
Yeah, I guess so.
I knew you had telekinesis.
Yeah, so did that happen, and apparently they're going to team up at Extreme Rules to take on Shane and Drew, Roman and Undertaker. Okay. I guess so.
Right.
Kofi defeated Sami Zayn, but then was attacked by Samoa Joe after the match, so we know what the next feud is for Kofi. So Samoa Joe loses U.S. title, immediately goes into the WWE Championship. And he's crossing brands because he ain't even on SmackDown, right? That's why I say the wild card rule is shit, because it doesn't necessarily... Like, you know, they not really observing any rules at this point. They just got dudes. You just go to whatever show you want to.
Right. True.
If Kofi comes to Raw every week, is it special him being on Raw?
Right. That's what I'm saying. Because then they move Roman to SmackDown.
And he's on Raw every week, Keish. So here's the thing.
If I didn't know any better, I would say Roman was still on Raw. I forgot he was a SmackDown guy, to tell the truth.
Only three
until
acts.
I just remembered.
Only three acts are supposed to come to the other brand by the wild card rule. Keith, Roman and Kofi come every week. Kofi brings the whole New Day.
Right.
Then Daniel Bryan and Rowan start to show up now. I'm already up to five people.
Right.
Now, Bayley be showing up on, you know, and now they try to use the title as a thing, but she's the SmackDown champion. Okay. Alexa Bliss go across both shows. I don't even know which one she on for sure. Lacey Evans will pop up on SmackDown when she want to. Becky Lynch will pop up on SmackDown when she want to.
Which don't make sense to keep the Raw Women's Champion. What are you talking about?
Yeah, so the wild card was supposed to be three people every week. It's about seven, because it's basically the whole roster. Everybody do what they want to do. As opposed to, hey, let's actually keep it to three people and then rotate it to the point of there's people that you just don't even get to see. See people you might not even see that much on SmackDown, right?
Right.
So if Cesaro... does it where he comes from Raw and goes to SmackDown for a special show, you might drum up some interest. I don't know. It's all just screwed up. But
yeah,
I digress.
Yeah. This Eric, Amy, Paul.
Yeah.
Just please, because I can't. It's ridiculous.
SmackDown doesn't have any standout moments, so. The New Day defeat Daniel Bryan Rowan. That breaks out to a melee because KO and Sami Zayn come down, but the Heavy Machinery get involved. So then it's Heavy Machinery and New Day. They defeat the other four.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the thing. Elias finally beats Miz. 2 out of 3 falls. Good job, Elias. Because he had to take a lot of losses lately between Roman and all that stuff. Like, he had to be getting his ass whooped. Right. Nikki Cross defeats Bayley. That matters for Alexa Bliss. Sonya Deville defeats Ember Moon. Oh, black women be getting trounced. So Sonya Deville crushes off Ember Moon. Alexa Bliss crushed off Naomi on Raw the night before. This is what Sasha Banks was talking about, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah, they don't care about us.
Yeah.
They don't care about us. That's why Sasha ain't came back yet.
Yeah.
She's like, yeah, I ain't finna deal with y'all. Maybe she'll come back when the new directors take over. Because ain't nobody got time. Like,
yeah.
And I'll be glad, too. Because I miss Sasha.
Yeah, we'll see. I don't think she's gone, right? Like, I don't think it's like a Leo Rush situation. Like, I think she is going to be back. And if they do it right, it really, really could be meaningful. But we'll see. I think we're going to do one more break. We'll do the news, and then we'll let you guys go home. But with that, let's hit the break, and then we'll be back.
You're standing by with comments.
Well, what you gonna do when Ric Flair, the Million Dollar Man, the Warlord, and the Mountie, the greatest Survivor 13 team of all time, runs wild on you?
Absolutely nothing, because you said it, brother, right here on this one team, there's never been a greater amount of talent in World Wrestling Federation history assembled in one corner ever. You've got law and order, you've got power, you've got the money, baby, and you've got the class of the real world champion. You can't beat that.
There's going to be a lot of electricity in the air, baby. And I'm going to tell you one thing, Piper. Once you all disappear one by one, you're going to be the last one that's going to find that out.
Everything's been said, but a picture is worth a thousand words.
Yeah. Yeah, boy. You're
like
the man.
Money to me, baby. Money
you're
in the bank.
All the way. You're the man.
All right. So let's hit news, Keish. So AWE on July 14th is doing Fight for the Fallen. It's a pay-per-view. It's going to be where they donate the proceeds to charity. And let me make sure I get all the information out right. So it's done by All Elite Wrestling. It's their third pay-per-view. It's going down in Jacksonville. And all the proceeds will be donated to the victims of gun violence. Right?
Yeah.
Right now, the matches are Brandi Rhodes and Allie, Kenny Omega versus Seema. This is where Cody and Dustin will face the Young Bucks. Adam Page will take on Kip Sabian. And it's been on the schedule for a while. The same night, Evolve is doing their 10-year anniversary show. Right?
Right.
Now, you know Evolve works with the WWE. They send a lot of NXT talent over to Evolve to, you know, give them some more time. Keish, the WWE has decided to stream Evolve 10 on the WWE Network. Same night as Fight for the Fallen. Basically counter-programming. And they're streaming it for free because it's going to be on the network.
Right.
So, are you going to watch the free show or are you going to watch the pay-per-view? Also at Evolve 10, you'll probably see guys like Roderick Strong. You'll see some other NXT talent. WWF is known to do counter programming, right? Like, that's what happens. Clash of the, well, WCW did it to WWF because that's where Clash of the Champions came from, right? In 88, they did Clash of the Champions the same night as WrestleMania 4. It worked out. So, skin. It's caused some ruffles, right? WWE has done counter programming to WCW before. They did the first Royal Rumble, I think, the same night as Starrcade or Super Brawl, and it was given away on free TV on USA. So it's been done before, right? all I can tell you is this. There's no real rules in wrestling, but I agree with the guys at AEW. Counter-programming a charity show is low. That's low as shit. Now, the WWE will say they're not counter-programming, but...
Right. No, you are. They're being petty. But you know what? To me, and this is just a little bit of a personal opinion, they've always played 30. You know what I'm saying? So, this is right up WWE's alley. Oh, we're not counter-programming, but you are, though. That's exactly what this is. You know what I'm saying? Because if you weren't, why would you have it the exact same night? You know what I'm saying? Did you plan this out already? Or was this something you did, a date you decided to come up with recently? You know, it's like, there's ways to do this without doing that. You know what I'm saying? Like, why can't everybody eat? And then not only that, but this is a charity event. You know, it's like, are you serious? You know, like, you're going to counter-program a charity event? Like, good God. You know, and you wonder why, like, the things that are said about you are said about you. Like, come on, man. Are you for real? And it feeds into what has been said about them, you know, about WWE by AEW, or has been mentioned, or, you know, whatever, however you want to call it. It's, you're proving this stuff to be true. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're not creating, because you're not worried about it. You don't see them as a threat, so you don't care. That's fine. But if you didn't care that much, why are you counter-programming something like that? What are you doing? You know, like, that to me is a whole other level of petty right there. Like, are you serious? You know, like, I can understand if this was just, you know, a regular pay-per-view or whatever like that. A charity event? You are ridiculous. Like, you just can't. I don't care what you say, it's the spirit of business or whatever. Like, they're not even, like, they're denying, we're not counter-programming. Yes, you are. Like, what?
Like,
it's in your nature.
Yeah, here's the thing. They didn't create a counter-program, but they took advantage of one that was already in place that night and said, hey, let's put this on. On the network, like putting it on the network, you know, like a show that people was going to pay for already, because the show was already in place, so that's fair. And I'm not blaming Evolve or nothing.
Right.
But, shoot, Keish, that's, it's kind of janky. Fair enough.
Right. No, it is.
CM Punk files a countersuit against Colt Cabana.
Really this, now?
Yeah, so this is getting messy. Like, you forget that these dudes was best friends. Like, we... Bryan, and a friendly reminder, we are a long-ass way from 2014.
Right.
So, basically, this is what happens. I filed suit against Punk because... For lawyer fees, right? Because... Right. Cabana said, Punk said he would pay the lawyer fees for this lawsuit that the WWE doc, the doctor, brought against them, basically saying slander. And I want to make sure I clear up, it's the doctor, not the WWE, even though the WWE helped the doctor with his legal.
Right.
Right? CM Punk filed a counter lawsuit against Colt Cabana. Punk is seeking $600,000 for general damage as well as interest and legal fees. Cabana legal must legally respond to Punk's countersuit by July 3rd. Puck and Cabana were co-defendants in this case against WWE physician Chris Amon, who sued them for defamation stemming from Puck's appearance on The Art of Wrestling. Puck and Cabana won the case, but here's a twist. Cabana filed suit against Puck, claiming a verbal agreement for Puck to pay his legal fees, which now led to Puck's countersuit. Cabana was seeking $200,000 for legal fees. Puck said he paid all the damn legal fees. I don't even know what he's talking about. And also, Puck, they said during the lawsuit, they requested that they take the podcast down. Cabana never took it down. I mean, you remember, Colt Cabana broke the internet and broke podcasting with that podcast.
Yeah, he did.
Because he had to figure out how to repost it under different things, because, like, trying to listen to it on Stitcher, it didn't come out right. iTunes couldn't, like, the servers just couldn't handle it. I'm sure he made a ton of money, right? Like, his ad revenue and all that stuff was huge. But, you know, neither here nor there, right? Like, it's... I just hope two friends can figure it out. Because this is very messy for two people who have been best friends for a long time.
Yeah, you know, you forget. I haven't forgotten, though. You know what I'm saying? These were best friends. They were like the best of friends. And for this to come between them, it sucks. You know what I'm saying? It is terrible. Because if it wasn't for them being so close, you know, CM Punk would have never made the podcast on an Outer Edge. He would have never did the Outer Edge in the first place. So, I personally feel like, you know, I hope that they are able to clear this up, you know what I'm saying, that they patch things out, you know, eventually they can become friends again, you know, like, because it's terrible. It's terrible. You know what I'm saying? And there are these, and CM Punk, you tell people these rumors of him being in AEW, because I ain't got time. Okay?
No. The videos that they showing are doctored. They are videos from some things that he did in the past that people splice stuff together. There, that's very creative.
Okay. I'm just saying.
Here's the thing. Right. I don't think Punk will come back to wrestling. Like, I think he's actually legitimately done. Like, everybody thinks he will, but it's kind of like, maybe he does, but I don't think AEW will be the spot right away for a variety of, I don't know if they're that interested. Like, I think they'll be interested in, like, the draw that it would have, but I don't know if they necessarily would want to deal with that right away, right?
You know, honestly, I feel like his time in WWE, you know, it really took the joy of wrestling from him. And that's why he will never return. I don't think it was just WWE. I think it was, you know what I'm saying? And then this stuff going on with Colt is not making it any better. You know, it's like wrestling, I feel, and I don't know, of course, I can't speak for him because, you know, I'm not him, but I feel like this might have put a permanent bad taste in his mouth when it comes to wrestling. You know, something that he loved so much and held so dear, like he just doesn't want to do anymore. You know, it's just become this traumatic experience that he just doesn't want to deal with again. You know what I'm saying? Because for AJ, you know, it just probably was the same thing, you know. Not so much so that it was traumatic, but just so much so that the joy of it is just, you know. And it's not like neither one of them, you know. One, they're married to each other. So that's one thing. And then two, it's not like either one of them is hurting something. You know what I'm saying? So I feel like, you know, they'll both be perfectly, they'll be, you know, they'll be well off without wrestling, but, you know, it sucks because these were two very incredibly talented people when it came to the ring. And, you know, wrestling hasn't been the same without them, but it's like, you know, no one should have to sacrifice their own happiness, you know what I'm saying? Just so that everybody else. It's a lot. You know, so I understand, you know, if he never steps in the ring again. You know, it's not like he hell, he could if anything, he could end up, you know, opening a wrestling school one day or something. You know, we don't know. But as of right now, I don't feel like he even touch it.
No.
Especially with all the stuff going on with Colt Cabana, like, nah.
Yeah.
Nah. Like, it's just not even happening.
I think he might do it, but it'd have to be like, all the stars would have to align. It'd have to be the right creative. It'd have to be the right payday. It'd have to, which mm-hmm. Whatever it was, it'd be a monstrous payday, right? Mm-hmm. But yeah, we'll see how that happens. The craziest story of this week is Tommy Dreamer, who on a podcast I've yet to listen to, stated that he almost committed a murder suicide at WrestleMania 17.
The fuck? Wait a minute. Oh.
So, put you in a time capsule. 2001, ECW closes, right?
That's my favorite WrestleMania, too. Wait a minute.
Yeah. One of the people who was left holding the bag was Tommy Dreamer when ECW closed, right? Mm-hmm. Taz had got out and went to WWF. The Dudleys had got out and went to the WWF. Tommy did not go to WWF or WCW. Raven is a WCW. You know what I mean? Tommy does not go anywhere. Tommy stays with the ship. Tommy was convinced by Paul Heyman that he should stay with the ship, that he should not take lucrative deals that were offered by WWF or WCW. Now, WCW subsequently closes, so that would have failed anyway. But Tommy is at ECW when they bounce the checks. You know what I mean?
Right.
Paul was the greatest Kool-Aid salesman in the world. Because he had them guys going there doing crazy stuff for money that wasn't that big. Guys were becoming stars but wasn't getting paid that much. But guys started getting opportunities at bigger promotions. He always put this us against them. They don't love us. You know what I mean? We this, we that, we the family. Paul was getting paid by the WWF under the table because Vince had an interest in what was going on down there. Vince was trying to help him keep afloat. That's why Paul seamlessly transitioned to a job at WWF after ECW closes. So, a lot of those guys felt betrayed, Tommy being one of them. Tommy felt like he was broke now. He stayed at his parents' house. All this shit. He went to WrestleMania 17. He was at the thing and he saw a sign because it's in Houston, it's in Texas. Very lax gun laws. And it was like, hey, you know, this, that, the third. And he talked to a guy. The guy basically said, look, man, yeah, you can bring your gun in here. This is Texas. We don't care about that shit. Right? Mind you, this is pre 9/11. So let's give that context to it too. Even though I think Texas gun laws are still very lax.
Yeah, they are.
So Dreamer was go buy a gun, go to the event, get down there on the front row, or get close, and nobody's gonna stop him. I mean, he got credentials, people know him, he's a wrestler. I don't know if he even had credentials or not. Jump the barricade, shoot Paul in the back of the head. And then pull the gun on himself. That was his plan. The world is glad that that did not happen. It's one of the best WrestleManias of all time. But aside from that, two people would have died. Who knows how the universe is altered from there. Paul is no longer in OVW. You know, it's just so much stuff going on, right? He said basically what stopped him from doing it, he got a call from Jim Ross, because Jim Ross, of course, was doing talent relations back then, and said, hey, man, we still thinking about you. We still interested. Yada, yada, yada. A couple of years later, Tommy's in WWE. But, hey, that shit is crazy, Keish. Like, 200% crazy.
If you can see my face right now, like, to know that he had planned this. Do Paul know this story?
He know it now. I don't know if he do it before then, sure. But he definitely do it now.
Man, I would shit myself if this was a story told about me. Like, wait, you had planned to shoot me and then shoot yourself at a live pay-per-view? Like, oh, no. Ooh, no. Like, That would terrify me. Like, what? Ooh, that story is insane. Like, you see the news and you see these things happen, but to hear the account of someone that like planned to do this, and the only thing that saves him, you know, it's like, wait, seriously? And he would have never got that call from Jim Ross. Two people would have been dead that night.
Well, here's the thing. Jim Ross probably read it and was like, ah, okay, makes sense.
right.
Paul right. probably read it and felt like, ah, makes sense. Because here's the thing. I don't think it's the first time somebody has talked about killing Paul.
No. I've watched the doc they did on him, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And, no, I'm pretty sure Paul doesn't have more than enough death threats. You know what I'm saying? I'm pretty sure he's still getting them. So, I don't think, at this point, I feel like with Paul, it's gotten to the point where he's probably numb to it. It's like, all right, yeah. Well, you know, it's just somebody else on the list that thought about killing me. It's like, I mean, like, at this point in my life, like, it might be just semi-normal. You know, it's like, you know, it's just somebody else to add to the list. Like, no, sir, that's not, but, you know, it's Paul Heyman that we're talking about here. You know, especially the story, like, the entire story of ECW. Like, broken down into detail. Like, it's like, oh no, I'm surprised that he's still walking in Britain. Like, that's really what it is. I don't know, man. But that is crazy. Like, that's utterly insane.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. I think the thing that's graphic is the idea of it happening at a pay-per-view. And
right.
Understand, 80,000 people was in that arena probably that night, right?
Mm-hmm.
How many people was watching live? I don't know what you do with that, man. Whew. That alters, like, the universe. Not just like wrestling. Like, this right. maybe go beyond wrestling. That alters the universe. Like, that's what people don't want to have live TV anymore. Like, it would be like, right. ooh, shit. So, yeah. yeah. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I just thought it was an interesting story. Seth Rollins is up the internet. I would like to put that. That's probably my final thing to cover tonight. His ideas of in interviews of what's going on with John Moxley, a.k.a. Dean Ambrose, and how to say the guy who took the ball and went home. Seth, who's at the top of the mountain, has been very defensive of the WWE as a company. He's talked about people just talking bad things about the WWE. And here's the thing. I agree with it. It's the best in the world there. You know how I know? Because they buy all the top talent, even when, you know. So they have the best in the right. world. That's fair.
Is this why they call Seth Rollins a kiss ass?
Yeah.
And saying that he's the WWE's do boy, and you know,
he been going back and forth with Will Ospreay on Twitter and stuff like that. Here's the thing. Nobody talks bad about their job on social media, right?
Right.
Period. Right. I don't talk bad about my job. I don't talk. If I do talk bad, I talk bad about it in a way. Y'all don't know where I work. The world know where he works, right? I don't talk about our competitors. I don't, whether it's glowing or bad, I don't do any of that. But what do you expect him to do, right? Like, I don't get, here's the thing. Full disclosure, if I ever start getting checks from WWE, what I probably have to stop doing a podcast. Or some, I can't give it away because then somebody would be like, no, I think he's still doing it. So I don't want to go there. But I probably have to stop doing it. But if they let me still do the podcast, because it'd be let because they're paying me, and probably the terms and conditions would have to include this, right? Mm-hmm. You think I'm about to be here like, hey, man, that writing was shit last week on Raw. No. Hey, man, you can say it's not credible or whatever, but I'm like, I don't think I would talk about. Here's the thing. I would talk about it, but I wouldn't talk about it too heavy. And I'm not talking about any other promotions after that. I'm not telling y'all what happened on Ring of Honor. I don't know Ring of Honor no more. Because I'm getting WWE checks. That's how it works. I don't know what happened in New Japan. Don't you better not talk to me about Impact. You try to impact my paycheck. Kiss my ass.
Let's put it in a better perspective, okay? Some people will go on social media and talk shit about their jobs, right? Job probably don't even look at social media, and if they do, they ain't gonna do shit, right? But we're talking about the champion of the biggest wrestling company, period. You know what I'm saying? Like, everybody knows WWE. It is an internationally publicly traded company. You know, people know the wrestlers. They know the name. If you say WWE to somebody, they probably won't even if you say it to like an older person, right? They're going to start asking you questions like, is such and such still wrestling? You know, and, you know, all that kind of stuff. No, Seth is not going to get on. Even when wrestlers do talk bad, quote unquote, about WWE, they tread their words very lightly. I mean, to the point where you don't know what they're talking about. You don't know if they're talking about the meal they ate last night or the match they had yesterday. You know, it's like, they censor themselves very well. The ones that haven't, we've seen what happened to them. Okay? So, no, Seth is not going to get on anything. Podcasts, interviews, blogs, Facebook, Twitter, none of that, and just trash WWE. You know what I'm saying? What he talk about behind closed doors and over the phone, you know, and all that shit, we don't know them conversations.
Well, but here's the thing.
What he do out in the public eye and on social media, yeah, he's going to big up the company that's giving him his check.
I believe what he's saying, and I believe he believes what he's doing because, one, it is the biggest wrestling company in the world. Sorry, hate to break everybody's heart, but the best basketball is the NBA. The best football is the NFL. You know what I'm saying? Like, let's go down the line here. The best hockey is probably the NHL. The best baseball is MLB. You work your whole life to get to that place, right? Even in those places, you work to be on the signature franchises. It's no coincidence that LeBron James, the greatest player of his generation, is playing for the Lakers. The Lakers are a staple franchise of the league, right?
Right.
The New York Yankees are a staple franchise of baseball. The Boston Red Sox are a staple franchise. It is what it is. The Dallas Cowboys and the Pittsburgh Steelers are staple franchises in the NFL. Like, there's just different levels to all of this, right?
Right.
And he's the top guy in the top company. And he feels like, well, you disrespect that, you disrespected his position. He has worked his whole life because he wanted to be the top guy in this business, right?
Right.
And quiet is kept. If you there, that's who you are. Now, you can debate whether, you know, some other things, but it is what it is, right? And that's just all he's saying. And different people have different opinions, which is funny because him and Will Ospreay had a funny back and forth. I liked when he was like, yeah, man, we got a guy who do what you do, but better. His name Ricochet. Like, it was funny. Ospreay has some points, too. Hey, man, look, every top guy in all these companies came from New Japan right now. But I'll say it's probably New Japan or TNA. But, Keish, I mean, hey, I like what he's doing. I think being online, having some spice to what you're doing, I think it's a good him. Maybe it's because he went Becky now. He's learning how to use this internet. Because I think it adds something to the thing. And then if anybody ever ends up in the same promotion at the same time, you can have some matches. But in the meantime, hey, let's have fun with this. Because we can't act like people aren't here in the world. So I think one of the things that wrestling is going to have to do, and they haven't really grasped yet, is how to use the social media to their advantage for creative.
Right.
So.
But they need to, you know who they need to take less. She know how to do that shit. Yeah. When she first turned, when she became the man, her social, her Twitter account was killing. I made sure I followed her. Well, I think I was already following her anyway. But, man, I made sure I checked her tweets every day. She was killing. But I think that's how you sell it. You know what I'm saying? And I think someone don't know how to sell it. She know how to sell it. So she's probably teaching that to Seth, like you say it, and now he's learning how to sell it. You know, it's like, at the end of the day, like, you know, and I know this ain't gonna happen, but I'm gonna say it anyway. You know, wrestling fans have got to stop, you know, oh, that's Vince's boy and blah, blah, blah. I mean, in some cases, yes. But every time somebody's like, oh, WWE is a shit, you know, it's like, why would they not say that? Like, are you serious? You know, everybody aspires to be in WWE, period. If you're a wrestler, male or female, could have started wrestling yesterday. You could have started wrestling 10 years ago. You know what I'm saying? Everybody tries to work up to this point. We're talking about the top guy in the top company. He's going to say these things. He's going to do these things. He believes in this because this is what he's wanted all his life. Like, come on now. If you work in your dream job right now, you understand that point. You know what I'm saying? Like, you understand, you know, where he's at that point. So you can't, to me, I feel like you can't sit here and shit on him for doing the thing that you would do if you had to defend your job. You know, it's like, seriously? That's ridiculous, but whatever. You know, people are going to do what they want to do anyway. But I was wondering where all those tweets is. Facebook statuses and stuff I was seeing was coming from. I was like, what the hell does Seth Rollins do? That got everybody calling him a kiss ass. That's saying he be brown over them and shit. What is this? Like, I did not know what was happening. I was really cool. Like, I was like, I don't know. What is it? You know, trying to find something? And I'm like, I don't know what's going on. It was just crazy to me. So, but I'm glad. I thank you for clarifying that for me.
Yeah. Yep. No problem. With that, I think we're gonna close it out here because we like to hit 2 hours. And I don't know. I don't have anything else. You got anything else?
No, I think I'm good, you know. Shout out to everybody that's downloaded the podcast and that's listening. And, you know, we appreciate our fans. We love y'all. Keep tuning in to us because, you know, we do this for us, but we do this for y'all too. This is fun. So, you know, hey. And I always leave you comments and stuff, you know. If y'all want to find me on Twitter, my name is Really No Keish. That's really, like the word really, no, N-O, Keish, K-E-S-H, you know. I am always open to Twitter comments and, you know, tweets and stuff. I don't know about DMs because I don't check those at all. So, don't do that. But, but you can always tweet me and everything. I will answer. And my Twitter's public. So, follow me if you want, you know. I'm out there. But if you get too ridiculous, I will block you. Just know that. I'm not above blocking people. Okay?
Nope.
I blocked Trump. I blocked you.
You blocked the president?
I sure did.
Well, you know, some people blocked him because I think they don't want to see his craziness. So it's like, hey, that way.
And that's
you,
exactly why I blocked him.
That way you can't retweet his craziness into your timeline.
No. Yeah, because for some reason he was showing up on my timeline, and I did not want to see that shit, so I blocked him. I was like, I don't want to see this. This is ridiculous. But I think I blocked his personal account. Mm. I don't think I blocked the POTUS account, but I need to block that too. So I'm just kind of like,
I haven't blocked him. I don't follow him, but I do kind of want to know what the president is saying from time to time, even if I think it's crazy. Now, what I won't do is tweet at him.
But that is the thing, right? Yeah.
No matter what the opinion is, I'm not tweeting at. I'm like, I'm not going at the president. Like, right. People be doing that in reckless, and I'm like, this dude too petty.
Yeah, no.
I ain't about to have Secret Service at my house.
Right. So I don't at him. I wasn't following him or nothing. But for some reason, his tweets would show up on my newsfeed. And I said, you know what? I don't have time for this. So I blocked him. I was like, I'm not even finna do this. I'm not finna play these games. I'm just not even finna do it. It's a free country in that aspect. Ain't nothing against the law against blocking him on Twitter. So I did it. You know what I'm saying? All right, I put it out there. You know? I'm pretty sure I ain't the only one that's ever done it. And I'm just like,
you know, oh no, I know quite a few people who have done it. I just, I don't know.
I've done it. Mm-hmm.
Like I said, I try to stay away from him and the social media altogether because,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I think I don't think there's any benefit from it, right?
Right. This is true.
So, but you know, here's a no. Oh, look at them exploit Darren Young and Sonya Deville. Oh, sorry. I got the WWE Network playing in the background.
No, you know, it's not. It's
Pride, but so I'm like, he don't even work there. But they got a picture of them together. I guess he must have showed up at a show. And it was like, because it's Pride, but they got old black shirts with some rainbow stuff. And, you know, it's like, oh, let's get some of that. Mind you, we are avid supporters of people who don't support that. But, okay.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's 2 hours in. I think we have provided an action-packed show with a lot of content and a lot of fun and a lot of laughs. And right. We appreciate y'all for listening. And we'll be back next week. And I don't know what the preview is or recap or whatever, but we'll have stuff. Oh, we did not talk Fighter Fest tonight, but we'll get to it next week. Why not?
Of course.
Anyway, with that being said, we are out. Have a good night. Peace.
Bye.